After discussing the death of Sauron in a previous video, I want to answer whether Sauron could return to trouble Middle-earth as an incarnation of evil. Was his fall at the end of the Third Age similar to that of his master Morgoth at the end of the First? What does Tolkien tell us about the return of fallen Dark Lords, and how does the One Ring fit into all this? This video is closely linked with the other, and you will find on screen and in the description links to my discussion about the death of Sauron. With Sauron's fall due to the destruction of the One Ring on March 25th in the year 3019 of the Third Age, he was utterly vanquished, falling so low that no one could see his return, the greater part of his spirit being removed from him apparently forever when the ring was unmade. With his master, known as Morgoth, he fell at the end of the First Age in the War of Wrath, his evil realm brought to naught, being thrust through the Door of Night beyond the circles of the world, into the timeless void by the Valar. Yet the lies that Melkor the Mighty and Accursed, Morgoth Bauglir, the power of terror and of hate, sowed in the hearts of elves and men, are a seed that does not die and cannot be destroyed, and ever and anon it sprouts anew, and will bear dark fruit even unto the latest days. Could Sauron re-emerge following the destruction of the One Ring? In terms of storytelling, had Sauron been able to reclaim the power of the One Ring that dissipated from it in its destruction, this would certainly lessen the scope of his great sacrifice in forging it in the first place, and the means for mortals to be able to put an end to him in Middle-earth. If he could reclaim that power through its unmaking, then arguably hiding the ring from him forever, or attempting to, would have been a better solution, though still a terrible one. Even if its destruction led to hundreds or thousands of years of freedom from his tyranny, Tolkien would be saying that evil would return eventually in the incarnation of Sauron returned and not Morgoth, which as I will discuss is a bigger deal. Though reclaiming that lost power would make what he achieved with the One Ring seem less of a bold move for complete power on his part. This is because of what he had given up in order to achieve a power beyond what is naturally available, achieving an enhancement of his power on Earth. This isn't the empowering of a spirit, allowing you to achieve greater things than previously thought, through your actions and growing wisdom. We see this with Glorfindel in his death and re-embodiment as a figure of even greater nobility and wisdom through his sacrifice and deeds. And we see it in the Lord of the Rings with the ring-bearer Frodo himself. He is apparently able to at least attempt to use the One Ring according to his own stature, confronting Gollum and demanding that he be gone, that he trouble him no more, declaring that Gollum will be cast into the fire of doom if he ever touches him again, Gollum being powerless to resist, backing away with terror in his eyes, despite still holding on to an insatiable desire for the ring Frodo carries. Frodo becoming a changed figure from the naive hobbit who set out from the Shire, a changed figure due to the wisdom he has gained, the experience through the hardship of his journey with the One Ring, and his growing understanding of its fell nature. With Sauron, it is not some natural progression through hardship. He perverted the natural order through the science of his ring-making, and sacrificed a great part of his power and will in an effort to grow even greater, to dominate others with ease through utilising that power to its full potential within a ring. The Ring of Sauron is only one of the various mythical treatments of the placing of one's life or power in some external object, which is thus exposed to capture or destruction, with disastrous results to oneself. If I were to philosophise this myth, or at least the Ring of Sauron, I should say that it was a mythical way of representing the truth that potency, or perhaps rather potentiality, if it is to be exercised and produce results, has to be externalised and so, as it were, passes to a greater or less degree out of one's direct control. The sacrifice I speak of is the removal of power that was a part of himself, that could not just be taken from him by another, but placing that into an object that could potentially be taken by others, being harnessed by others on Earth. This is what Sauron had to do in order to create a ring of power so great that it could be the master ring over all others, and to dominate his great enemies in Middle-earth. Forging another ring wasn't enough, it had to be fundamentally greater, and this required Sauron to make this sacrifice, binding his fate to the fate of the ring, placing his power into the physical world and outside of himself, in order to lord over those who relied on the physical world for their own existence, the Incarnates. To paraphrase of the Rings of Power and the Third Age, the power of the Great Rings was bound up with the One Ring. They would be subject wholly to it, to last as long as it lasts, and much of Sauron's strength and will passed into the ring, for the power of the elven rings was very great, and that which should govern them must be a thing of surpassing potency. While Sauron wore the ring, he perceived all things that were done by the other great rings. He could see and govern the thoughts of those that wore them. To be able to merge once again with this lost power goes against the nature of the ring's creation. It removes the sacrifice and risk in making it. The removal of an inherent power to place into something foreign is the removal of the power from its natural place. Even though Sauron was in rapport with the One Ring, as Tolkien says in letter 131 to Milton Waldman, being its lord and natural owner, becoming enhanced on Earth while he wore it, the damage had already been done in terms of reclaiming it or becoming one with it again. Great sacrifices like this can't just be undone. Tolkien describes this as the weakness of Sauron's plan in the same letter. The power of the ring existing even if Sauron did not carry the ring, meaning he was not diminished if he did not carry it. He was just unable to benefit from its power if he didn't carry it. But another could seize it and become possessed of it. If they were sufficiently strong and heroic in nature, they could challenge Sauron and become master of all that he had learned or done since its making. They would overthrow him and usurp his place. Mastering the One Ring completely, and not just being able to wield it, means the same for Sauron as throwing the ring into the fire. That power he removed from himself would be theirs, bound to them through their lordship of the ring, and Sauron would diminish. But what about Morgoth and his defeat and possible return? Instead of Sauron's master ring, we have Morgoth's ring. The attempt of Morgoth to utterly control that which he claimed as his own, his attempt to identify himself with Arda, becoming synonymous with it. Arda that he declares as his own kingdom, naming it unto himself. Through the release of his own power into the flesh of Arda, he achieved the corruption of everything, from minor influence to complete control, becoming weaker as an individual being that can be fought and chained, but having his spirit spread throughout physical and metaphysical existence. Those relying on the flesh of Arda, the incarnates, becoming poisoned by the stain of Morgoth, corrupted in some way. I speak more about Morgoth's ring in my video What is Morgoth's Ring? And my podcast episode The Marring of Arda and Morgoth's Ring. But let's look at the following passage. Dark spirit of Melkor's remainder might be expected therefore, eventually and after long ages, to increase again, even as some held, to draw back into itself some of its formerly dissipated power. But all simply to recover enough strength to return to the attack on the Valar, and to its old obsession. Some may see this as some get-out clause that Sauron could take advantage of theoretically, but there are some fundamental differences between Morgoth, Sauron, Morgoth's Ring, and the One Ring. The first is that Sauron released the greater part of his power into one physical object, a ring he could wear and wield, and when that was destroyed, all that he had removed from himself to make it was gone. With Morgoth, he imbued Arda itself, especially Middle-earth, with his power. So when he was executed and banished as a maimed spirit at the end of the first age, his power he had released from his own being still existed in what he had poured it into. The tyrant Morgoth had been diminished, but the kingdom of Morgoth had not. Morgoth's ring still existed. Their defeats are not the same. To be equivalent, Sauron's ring would have to still exist and only his form on Earth physically defeated. Or Morgoth's ring would have to be unmade, which means the annihilation of Arda and those within it. And Tolkien is clear that despite Morgoth and Sauron both being of the Ainur, and talk of Sauron being effectively greater than Morgoth in the Second Age as a Dark Lord in his own right, Sauron was not Morgoth. We speak of Morgoth being weakened, shrunken, reduced, but Tolkien says this is only in comparison to the great Valar, all of whom were the powers of Arda and greater than even the greatest of the Maiar. Tolkien saying in Morgoth's Ring that Morgoth's potential return to become a threat would be possible for him, even if not possible for Sauron, because of his relative greatness. Meaning that even through the Door of Night, Melkor's obsession would remain. He had never repented, never turned from what he desired, and still retained relics of wisdom. It could still seek its object indirectly and not merely blindly. It would rest, seek to heal itself, distract itself by other thoughts, desires and devices, but only to make war on the Valar. As Melkor grew in strength again, it would become a dark shadow, brooding on the confines of Arda, yearning towards it before the time was right. None of this being possible for Sauron, who even in the greatest days of his power on Earth was not the Valar Melkor or the dark tyrant Morgoth. Sauron was diminished, maimed, invisible to the eyes of men whom he wished to dominate. He could not return. His ring, despite its greatness, being a trinket when compared to the ring of Morgoth that continued to poison existence. Sauron being a threat that men had to deal with on Earth to usher in the Age of Men, the Dominion of Men. Morgoth being the adversary of the Valar and Arda as a whole, the looming threat biding its time outside the borders of Arda until the dawn of the End of Days. Thank you for watching this video, and I hope you watched or will watch my video on whether the Dark Lord Sauron died with the destruction of the One Ring, and what death really means in Tolkien's works. I also have playlists dedicated to both Morgoth and Sauron. If you enjoy this content and want to help support my efforts on YouTube, you can join Patreon or become a YouTube member through the links in the description. I appreciate everyone who offers their support, and want to thank some members in particular. Dovid, Joel, Aelin, Oliver, Victus, Grant, and Patricia. I hope everyone will return for the next chapter. Thanks.